Now, I've worked out with the ushers. It worked really good last night. It was raining during Mass. And so we made an agreement. They're to raise their hand, one, if I should give a shorter homily so you can get out before it pours again, or it's pouring so bad that I better keep you here a little longer, and I'll raise two for the longer one. They're saying one. Yesterday, actually, people in the congregation went like this. Little did they know. Okay, but they left, and it was not raining. Guess what? By the time I got out of your church, it's pouring down rain on me. And all the others were gone. But that's how it goes with the Lord, doesn't it? You know, all week long during the daily Mass readings, we've been reading from the prophet Amos. And it isn't Amos and Andy, you know, like a comic thing. It's tough reading. And it's tough hearing it. And it was tough for him to deliver it. Because, you see, he really had to confront the Israelite people in their faith and show and tell them about their sins. So it starts off like part one, is everything they're doing wrong? And it was pretty lengthy. Then the second part was Amos telling the people how God had always been faithful to them. And the list goes on of all the things that God had done for them in history. And then the last part was perhaps the harder part to hear, because it's all the punishments they're going to receive. Wow. But today it's so refreshing to hear from the prophet Zechariah, who says, shout with joy and praise, because the one that's coming to save you is simple, humble, meek, and peace will just exude from everything and give you joy, happiness. And that's what Jesus did, even to the point of saying he would enter riding on an ass. And Jesus on Palm Sunday rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. Okay, I won't say it twice. And so we see that Jesus' building of the kingdom is to help people understand a few things. First of all, God intends us to be filled with joy and gladness. And I really like the gospel today. I think it's so appropriate, these readings, especially on Independence Day weekend, that we would hear about something God desires of it. What God desires from us and of us is that we rest, that we relax, that we take time to become rejuvenated, rekindled, recreated. In other words, to know what leisure is all about. Now, in the golden olden days, when I was a youngster, Sunday was a real special day, I'll tell you. You got up in the morning and washed, even though you had taken your bath on Saturday night. And there they were, all of our Sunday clothes. The white shirt, starched. Starched. Ties, pants, belts, socks, shoes, jackets. And we all hurried and scurried because you couldn't eat because you had to fast before Mass, 3 hours at that time. And so as we're going out the door, we see other families coming down, and there's this like almost a procession to the church, the parish church. Now, I've told you before, I was raised in the Italian section of town, all the Italians. So we're going to St. Anthony of Padua Parish, where at that time the Mass was in Latin and the sermon given in Italian. And if you wanted to know what the priest said, you stayed after Mass for the English sermon. And I was able to see by the time I was almost out of grade school, it switched around where the homily that was given at the proper time was in English. And if you wanted to know what he said it after Mass in Italian. But the point is everybody gathered there. Everybody went across to this store called DeStefano's and bought the Sunday paper, walked another block down to the Italian bakery and got a couple loaves of... Okay. Is that... And, you know, it's over. That means it's done. Oh, wow. Don't you put that one up. And you saw everybody doing the same thing, and they were chatting, and the little, you know, little Italian ladies, real short, with their hats, and going, you know, what they're having for supper, what they made, oy, 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 you know, this and all that kind of stuff. And so we walked home, and it was like another parade home, everybody having their church bulletin, their newspaper, their bread, you know, and talking about who they'd seen, and a couple of classmates joined you, and you skipped, and you walked, and whatever, and you got home. And on Sunday, those white starched shirts didn't come off until the signal. And you never knew when the signal was coming. It could be 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock. And then when they said, okay, you can put your play clothes on. You know, that's when we had Sunday clothes, play clothes, school clothes, all this stuff. You never saw a dash going in and then hollering up the staircase, hang everything up. No taking down and throw it. But Sunday was the day we stayed together. And the reason we kept those church clothes on was primarily because either we were having company, right? Or we were going some other place. We were the company going. And on the kitchen counter, Mama baked up delicacies, cakes, fancy ones, pies, fudge, brownies, biscotti, pizzelle, and a sign, do not touch, taking to Aunt Rita's. Or sometimes it was even loaded larger. More than one cake, more than one pie, several boxes of cookies all stacked up in shirt boxes, and a bigger sign, do not touch for church bake sale. Oh, are we going to get any? But you see, it was all around the church and your family on Sunday. And do you know when I was born, I bet you won't believe it, they didn't even invent malls yet. There wasn't any mall. There weren't any malls. Oh my. All the stores were closed. Anybody remember that? We had what they called blue laws. You had to be closed on Sunday. So you hung out with your family. You went where they went. You hosted and helped with everybody coming to your house if it was your turn. And if not, you maybe did something as your family. You went on a picnic, you cooked outside, you played croquet or horseshoes, badminton, volleyball, whatever it was. We even used to play football in the street. But, you know, when you look at all that, all of our friends and neighbors were doing exactly the same thing. They had gone to church, and they too were coming home to a big salad, enzalada, meatballs, pasta, roasted rosemary chicken and potatoes, peas with mushrooms. Sound good? You've already had your supper, so you're not going like, ooh, ah. And then, you know, how long it, then there was other things too. Maybe a lasagna popped out or whatever, but anyhow, we were around that table, or at least the old people were around the table for 2 and 3 hours, talking, drinking wine, eating fruits and cracking nuts and just having a good old time. And you played with your cousins, you fought with your cousins, you wrestled with them, and then all you were waiting for is that dessert is being served. You see, what they had to do was take off the tablecloth and all the dirty napkins that were linen, by the way, and ironed each week, put a new tablecloth off, put out special dessert dishes, silverware, and containers of nuts and candies and whatever, and always the liquor tray where all the cordials were. And then the coffee was brewing. And then the cake came out and the pie or whatever it was we were having. Okay, kids, come and get it. We'd run in and get our hunk of pie and jello and candy. You know what I'm saying? And whatever they gave us to drink. And I love red wine, by the way. I forgot to tell you this part. And that's all their fault. Because when we were little kids, they put little shot glasses by our table setting. And they put real wine in it, and we could have it. I think it had a little bit of water at the beginning. But I liked it. I still like it. You can ask my sister Rose. But what I'm saying is, it was such a time preparing for Sunday. All the main cooking was prepared and done on Saturday, the baking. Meatballs were made, sauce was made, with Italian sausage maybe, whatever. I told you we bought the bread, but everything was ready to roll, homemade pasta. And so Sunday was to be a day of rest and family. And that's how God wanted it. You know what that means? Is like the Jewish people have Sabbath, right? You know that? Well, this was our Sabbath, and Sabbath means rest. It's the same root word to be used for sabbatical. I mean taking a break and get rejuvenated. So every Sunday, Sabbath, we were to rest, the Lord's rest. And we get this from the Jewish people. They did no work at all on the Sabbath. In fact, I was in Israel a lot of times, and on their Sabbath, Saturday, they did no work, as I said. And so we stayed at hotels that had Sabbath hotels, elevators. What's that, you say? Well, these were elevators that were programmed to stop and open and close on every floor, because to press the up or the down button was work. I kind of like their concept of work. But what do we do on Sunday? It's the largest retail day of the week. Go look at the outlet malls. When I'm helping out at the Shrine, oh my goodness, the traffic from the outlet malls and the Basilica traffic, it's one holy nightmare. So I wait till everybody goes before I leave. It's just a mess. And malls are thriving and all of this stuff. And none of that existed when I grew up, because we centered in on one another. We centered in on family. We centered in on, later on, I got to understand, taking a nap after you ate all that pasta and whatever it was, gnocchi, lasagna. You know, you needed a break. So you took a little siesta until you heard the dessert was ready. But it was meant to be a day of rest, a day of fellowship, a day of just doing different things together with others and not worried about beat the clock. Did I get the laundry done? Is the ironing done? Did I get the grass mowed? Did I wash the windows? You know, did I run to the store and get the week's worth of groceries? Do you get my drift? So when is your Sabbath day? When you rest with your family and friends and God. Does anybody have any anymore? You do? Don't do anything on a certain day? Go to church? And you go to church? Yes, okay. But you see what I'm saying? We lost it. And, you know, it'll never change. I'll know. I'll be dead long and gone. When we succeed as a Christian community with all the communities and stop going to the malls and all these shopping places, they'll eventually close. And you know that's not going to happen. It should. To show us how important it is to be together and to honor the Lord's Day. Starting with Mass as a family, family dinner with the extended family, immediate family, whatever, a special time, special clothes to rest. We've lost our ability to relax in our country. We're the leading country in medications for nervousness, depression, anxiety disorders, sleeplessness, insomnia, for ulcers, for like Nexium, the purple pill, you know. We get all angst and stressed, so we got to go see the counselor. In the old days, they just talked to one another over the fence or in the house or over a cup of coffee, and they had their therapy. Now we pay for it. You see, when you look around and see all of this, you begin to see, I want you to know, this is not what God wants. He wants you to be happy, joy-filled, but with one another, husbands and wife and their children, grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins, neighbors, widows, whatever, friends you gather, you make, church people. You see, we are to come as a gathering on Sunday in the Lord's house and in our own homes. And it's a good thing. We're so distant from that. And so today's homily is about inviting you to just take a look at your life. Do you have a Sabbath rest time where God is your focus, where God is honored by who you're having dinner with or supper or lunch or brunch, whatever, instead of doing, got to get this done, this done, this done, and we lose the whole meaning of what this day is all about. So Jesus says, if you have problems, whatever they might be, come to me. Did you hear him? He invited you. Come to me, all you who labor. We work. We have labors and struggles, right? All you who are burdened, we're all burdened with something. There's something weighing on us, whatever it might be. He says, and I will refresh you. I will take it, and I'll carry it. But you take my yoke upon you. You know, the oxen yoke? And it's light and airy. It's nothing compared to our own problems. So the Lord invites you to seek out leisure, relaxation, and rest. And on this Independence Weekend, where we celebrate our independence, we take for granted our religious freedoms that are evaporating. And so we need to focus more on God. It begins with each one of us, each congregation, each family, each nation, to come under God, one nation, indivisible. So let us help one another along the way and remind someone, did you take your Sabbath time, your Sabbath with God, your rest with God? Say, yeah, I said a few prayers before I went to bed. That's not what I'm saying. Do you catch it? It's a lifestyle. It's an orientation where that time, that day becomes the most special of the week, because you're going to be happy and joy-filled, surrounded by people who love you and people you love. And God is in the center of it all. He always is and always should be, by the way. So, brothers and sisters, what I experienced as a child and growing up in my early years, well into high school, I cherish very dearly, because it looked like the whole world and felt like it in the quietness and the steel town industry. Things quieted and people honored God. Paul tells us, you are not in the flesh, you are in the Spirit. We are in the Spirit of God. And so we need to act accordingly. Living by the flesh, he says, will get you death. But living in the Spirit of God will gain you life. So that's why the reading from the prophet fits in. Rejoice. There's peace is flowing. It's available through the Savior, through God. But if we don't make time for God together, we miss out. And how much we're missing out. So rest, relax, take some leisure. Celebrate the Sabbath and celebrate your family, your loved ones, and rejoice that God loves you so much, that he blessed you so abundantly. May God bless you now in his peace. And no matter what cross you may be carrying, he'll take and help you with it so you can get a break. That's the kind of God I want to serve. That's the kind of God I believe in. That's the God I like to preach and tell others and encourage. God of love, hope, a God who's generous in graces and blessing and gifts. why not acknowledge them one day a week? God bless you.